Good morning, everyone.
Good morning.
Thank you, Caleb, for bringing us into the presence of the Lord. That beautiful rendition of Amazing Grace.
Okay.
All right. Got a few announcements this morning. Congregational meeting will be on April 9th, Palm Sunday, a week from today. Talk over some issues that went around to the operations here, so we encourage you to stay after the service. Next Sunday, following the service, and grab a donut or whatever's down there and some coffee, and we'll talk over some stuff. Also, if you notice, there's a sign up downstairs for a funeral committee. We're needing some help that we can have kind of a calling tree type of thing, that when that point comes that someone from our congregation goes up and meets the Lord in heaven, then we need to have our celebration of life. We need some people to help with the serving, setting up, distribution of food, cleanup afterwards. We could really use some help with that. So we have a sign up downstairs. God's touching your heart on that. Please sign up. We're continuing our Wednesday Lent services this Wednesday. The service will be at 7:15. Pastor Glenn Sokolowski will be here and will be preaching. And then the following Wednesday will be the last Wednesday for our Lent services. And we will be having a potluck dinner that day. There's a sign up downstairs if you care to bring something. And Pastor Jody Becker will be preaching that day. Check your bulletin for everything else. There's all kinds of stuff in there. And make sure you read through that to see what's going on right here. Thank you, Roy and Mary Ann, for the lovely flowers. They're very beautiful. It adds a nice touch of color up here. I think we are ready to worship our Lord. Our opening hymn is Come to Calvary's Holy Mountain. Going to be working on the green hymnal today, number 301. Please rise as you are able.
So that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways
the glory of your holy name. Amen.
Almighty God, in his mercy, has given his Son to die for us, and for his sin, forgives us all of our sins. As a called and ordained minister of Lutheran congregations and missions for Christ, and by God's authority, I therefore declare to you the entire forgiveness of all of your sins, in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Please be seated. Four verses from our hymn, All Hail the Power of Jesus' Name, number 328 in the Green Hymnal, just the first four verses. Thanks, Dale. Righteous, the Lord has exalted his glorious law.
The psalm today is Psalm 142, located in page 285 in your green hymnal. I will begin with the odd, and you will respond with the even. I cry to the Lord with my voice. To the Lord I make loud supplication.
I pour out my complaint before him and tell him all my trouble.
When my spirit languishes within me, you know my path. In the way wherein I walk, they have hidden the trap for me.
I look to my right hand and find no one who knows me. I have no place to flee to, and no one cares for me.
I cry out to you, O Lord. I say, you are my refuge, my portion in the land of the living.
Listen to my cry for help, for I have been brought very low. Save me from those who pursue me, for they are too strong for me.
Bring me out of prison that I may give thanks to your name. When you have dealt bountifully with me, the righteous will gather around me. The second lesson today is the fifth chapter of Ephesians, beginning with the eighth verse. For once you were full of darkness, but now you have light from the Lord. So live as people of light, for this light within you produces only what is good and right and true. Carefully determine what pleases the Lord. Take no part in the worthless deeds of evil and darkness. Instead, expose them. It is shameful even to talk about the things that ungodly people do in secret, but their evil intentions will be exposed when the light shines on them, for the light makes everything visible. This is why it is said, "Awake, O sleeper, rise up from the dead, and Christ will give you light." Here ends the second lesson. Please rise as you are able for the reading of the gospel.
Could be seen in him. We must quickly carry out the tasks assigned us by the one who sent us. The night is coming, and then no one can work. But while I am here in the world, I am the light of the world. Then he spit on the ground, made mud with the saliva, and spread the mud over the blind man's eyes. He told him, "Go wash yourself in the pool of Shalom." Shalom means sent. So the man went and washed and came back seeing. His neighbors and others who knew him as a blind beggar asked each other, "Isn't this the man who used to sit and beg?" Some said he was, and others said, "No, he just looks like him." But the beggar kept saying, "Yes, I am the same one." They asked, "Who healed you? What happened?" He told them, "The man they called Jesus made mud and spread it over my eyes and told me, 'Go to the pool of Shalom and wash yourself.' So I went and washed, and now I can see." "Where is he now?" they asked. "I don't know," he replied. Then they took the man who had been blind to the Pharisees, because it was on the Sabbath that Jesus had made the mud and healed him. The Pharisees asked the man all about it. So he told them, "He put the mud over my eyes, and when I washed it away, I could see." Some of the Pharisees said, "This man Jesus is not from God, for he is working on the Sabbath." Others said, "But how could an ordinary sinner do such miraculous signs?" So there was a deep division of opinion among them. Then the Pharisees again questioned the man who had been blind and demanded, "What's your opinion about this man who healed you?" And the man replied,
I think he must be a prophet. The Jewish leaders still refused to believe the man had been blind and could now see, so they called in his parents. And they asked them, "Is this your son? Was he born blind? If so, how can he now see?" His parents replied, "We know this is our son and that he was born blind, but we don't know how he can see or who healed him. Ask him. He is old enough to speak for himself." His parents said this because they were afraid of the Jewish leaders, who had announced that anyone saying Jesus was the Messiah would be expelled from the synagogue. That's why they said, "He is old enough, ask him." So for the second time, they called in the man who had been blind and told him, "God should get the glory for this, because we know this man, Jesus, is a sinner." "I don't know whether he is a sinner," the man replied, "but I know this, I was blind, but now I can see."
"But what did he do?" they asked. "How did he heal you?"
"Look," the man exclaimed, "I told you once.
Didn't you listen?
Why do you want to hear it again? Do you want to become his disciples too?" Yeah. Yeah. Then they cursed him and said, "You are his disciples, but we are disciples of Moses. We know God spoke to Moses, but we don't even know where this man comes from."
"Why, that's very strange," the man replied. "He healed my eyes, and yet you don't know where he comes from? We know that God doesn't listen to sinners, but he is ready to hear those who worship him and do his will. Ever since the world began, no one has been able to open the eyes of someone born blind. If this man were not from God, he couldn't have done it."
"You were born a total sinner," they answered. "Are you trying to teach us?" And they threw him out of the synagogue.
Now when Jesus heard what had happened, he found the man and asked, "Do you believe in the Son of Man?" And the man answered, "Who is he, sir? I want to believe in him."
"You have seen him," Jesus said, "and he is speaking to you."
"Yes, Lord, I believe,"
the man said, and he worshiped Jesus. Then Jesus told him, "I entered this world to render judgment, to give sight to the blind and to show those who think they see that they are blind." Some Pharisees who were standing nearby heard him and asked, "Are you saying we're blind?" "If you were blind, you wouldn't be guilty," Jesus replied. "But you remain guilty because you claim you can see." This is the gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Christ.
Please be seated. Sherlock Holmes and Dr. Watson went on a camping trip. After a good meal and a bottle of wine, they went down for the night and went to sleep. Now, some hours later, Holmes awoke and nudged his faithful friend. "Watson, look up and tell me what you see." Watson replied, "I see millions and millions of stars." Sherlock Holmes then said, "And what does that tell you?" Watson pondered for a minute. "Astronomically, I believe that there are millions of galaxies and potentially billions of planets. Astrologically, I observe that Saturn is in Leo. Horologically, I deduce that the time is approximately 3:15. Meteorologically, I suspect that we will have a beautiful day tomorrow. And theologically, I can see that God is all-powerful and that we are small and insignificant." "Why? What does it tell you?" To which the ever-observable Sherlock Holmes then repeated, "Watson, my good man, what this really means is that someone has stolen our tent." Sometimes we are blind to what is going on right in our midst. And in a spiritual sense, we can also be blind to what God is doing right in front of us as well.
Our story today unfolds as Jesus and his disciples are walking through Jerusalem on their way out of the temple area. And verse 1 tells us that the disciples see a man who is blind. In fact, has been blind from birth. And the disciples ask Jesus in verse 2, "Rabbi, why was this man born blind? Was it because of his own sin or his parents' sins?" Now, there was a common understanding at that time that when some tragedy or illness occurred, it was God's way of punishing people for their sin. However, Jesus immediately brings clarification to this by saying in verse 3, it was not because of his sins or his parents' sins. Jesus tells the disciples that the man's blindness has nothing to do with sin, either in this man's life or his parents. And so in the next verses, Jesus tells about the true reason for the blindness that's happening here. Jesus first addresses a physical blindness in a man who was blind from birth. And then Jesus confronts some Pharisees who had the handicap of a spiritual blindness instead. Verses 13 through 15 tell us the Pharisees want to know how the blind man receives his sight. And they want to find out everything they can about this healer who dares to heal on the Sabbath. And then verse 16 speaks about how the Pharisees completely missed the point that the man's healing is a miracle. Yet, that doesn't seem to matter to them. The only thing on the Pharisees' mind is to criticize Jesus for healing on the wrong day. Now, the Pharisees are not sure they even believe the man was healed. So they question the parents in verses 19 through 21. They ask them, "Is this your son? Has he been born blind? If so, how can he now see?" His parents replied, "We know this is our son and that he was born blind, but we don't know how he can see or who healed him. Ask him. He is old enough to speak for himself." And when meeting with their parents did not prove helpful in their quest to disprove Jesus, then they come back to the healed blind man in verses 24 through 25. So for the second time, they called in the man who had been blind and told him, "God should get the glory for this because we know this man, Jesus, is a sinner." The man didn't understand how he had been healed. And he certainly didn't know or understand all the theology behind his healing. However, there was one thing he definitely did understand. He had been blind, but now he could see. This man could now see because of Jesus. And so now we begin to understand that the people who are really blind are actually the religious leaders. They had good physical eyes, but spiritually they were completely blind. Now here's where the discussion between the healed blind man and the Pharisees gets rather entertaining. Verses 26 through 27 tell us, "But what did he do?" they asked. "How did he heal you?" "Look," the man exclaimed, "I told you once. Didn't you listen? Why do you want to hear again? Do you want to become his disciples too?" Now that went over real well. The Pharisees then claim that Jesus could not have come from God in verses 28 through 29. The Pharisees say this, "Then they cursed him and said, 'You are his disciples, but we are disciples of Moses. We know God spoke to Moses, but we don't even know where this man comes from.'" And now the blind man who is now healed and can see gives this awesome comeback in verses 30 through 33. "Why, that's very strange," the man replied. "He healed my eyes, and yet you don't know where he comes from? We know that God doesn't listen to sinners, But he is ready to hear those who worship him and do his will. Ever since the world began, no one has been able to open the eyes of someone born blind. If this man were not from God, he couldn't have done it. So who is really blind from our gospel text for today? Here we have a blind beggar seeing more clearly than the religious leaders. Later on, when Jesus returned to the man, he fell at Jesus' feet and worshiped him. The now healed man not only saw with his physical eyes, but he saw with spiritual eyes as well. And so Jesus proclaims in verse 39, I entered this world to render judgment, to give sight to the blind, and to show those who think they see that they are blind. For all their knowledge of the scripture and religious practice, the Pharisees were completely missing the truth of God's kingdom. And yet a poor blind man had found this truth. His eyes were opened. Theirs remained closed. And here's what this means to us. You can enter into God's kingdom if you are physically blind. However, you cannot enter if you are spiritually blind. And Jesus proclaims this truth to the Pharisees in verses 40 through 41. Some Pharisees who were standing nearby him asked, are you saying we're blind? If you were blind, you wouldn't be guilty, Jesus replied. But you remain guilty because you claim you can see. In his book, More Jesus, Less Religion, Steve Arterburn writes this. Some time ago, I read about the work of a Wycliffe Bible translator in a remote village in Papua New Guinea. When the opening chapters of Genesis were first translated into the native language, the attitude toward women in the tribe changed overnight. They had not realized or understood that the woman who had been specially formed out of the side of the man. Without even hearing this concept developed, these people immediately grasped the ideas of equality between the sexes and then began adjusting their behavior. The people heard, they believed, they obeyed, and they changed. Just like that. Steve Arterburn goes on to say this. Now that change doesn't mean everyone in the tribe immediately came to faith in Christ, however. While they immediately recognized the respect God has for both men and women, the members of this tribe had their own heart to abandon gods and superstitions. And one of their practices was to spit on the wounds of the sick. Their medicine men were known as the spitters. And they did not want someone like Jesus to take away their status in the village. However, that attitude changed as more of the Bible was translated into the tribe's dialect. When the translators read the passage where Jesus cured a blind man in a rather unusual way, the medicine men pricked up their ears. Jesus had spit on the ground, made a paste of mud, put it on the man's eyelids, told him to wash it off, and the man was healed. When the translators read the passage when Jesus cured a blind man in their own language, they saw that Jesus was not against them, but actually rather for them. They found one of their own, a savior who is also a spitter. And so they came to the Lord because of this connection. These simple people in Papua New Guinea heard the truth of Scripture and they responded. They saw with spiritual eyes, 2,000 years later, the event that of what the religious people who were actually there and saw the miracle were not able to see. And yet,
The most important part of this message in these verses is not one that is so obvious. Another important point being made by Jesus here is about the hope of a new world. It's a hidden message which requires spiritual eyes to see. When the disciples ask Jesus whether the man's blindness was caused by his sin or his parents' sins, Jesus replies in verse 3. It was not because of his sins or his parents' sins, Jesus answered. This happened so the power of God could be seen in him. We usually think of these words in relation to what Jesus is going to do by healing the blind man. However, I think that Jesus has something even greater in mind. The work of God in this man's life is actually going to point to something larger that God is going to do with the rest of the world. Wrapped within this man's healing, there contains the promise of the final healing that God will bring to the whole earth. It's the mustard seed in the ground. It's the yeast hidden in the dough. It's the treasure hidden in a field. And it's what the whole world is moving toward. When this season of Lent concludes and we celebrate the resurrection of our Lord Jesus on Easter morning, that resurrection is a sign and promise that there is more to come for all believers and also to this world. Book of Revelations, chapter 21, verses 3 through 5, promises of a restoration of all things, and that the pain and sickness of this world, along with death, will be no more. Listen to these great words of promise. I heard a loud shout from the throne saying, look, God's home is now among his people. He will live with them, and they will be his people. God himself will be with them. He will wipe every tear from their eyes, and there will be no more death or sorrow, crying or pain. All these things are gone forever. And the one sitting in the throne said, look, I am making everything new. So what happens when blindness meets the light of the world? When sinners meet the Savior? When hunger meets the bread of life? When thirst meets the living water? When lost sheep meet the good shepherd? And the rejected meet incarnate love. And the dead meet the one who is the resurrection and the life. This is what happens. The blind receive their sight. The sinful receive forgiveness. The hungry are filled and satisfied. The lame walk. The sick are cured. People are made whole. The hopeless find hope. Spiritual prisoners are set free. Those who mourn are filled with joy. And the dead are raised, and eternal life is inherited. Matthew chapter 25, verse 34 says this. Then the king will say to those on his right, come, you who are blessed by my Father, inherit the kingdom prepared for you from the creation of the world. Church, that's the promise of the risen eternal Christ. And that's what we celebrate each and every Easter. All of us are blind and in need of Jesus' touch. And one day our healing will be complete on that day when God will make everything new. Let us pray. Father in heaven, we thank you that you love us so much, even in our sinful condition, that you sent your one and only Son to this earth to teach us, live with us, and ultimately die for us. Help us, Lord, to not be blind to those awesome promises that are in your holy word and to the truth that is in your Son, Jesus' name. And it is in his name that we pray. Amen. Sunday school time. Have fun, kids. You're doing the world easy.
Our next hymn, oh, I don't know if you guys know this one. Holy, holy, holy. Oh, yeah, Green Hymnal Yet number 165.
There's nothing in this world that can give us that righteousness except you and your son, Jesus. Lord, help us this Lenten season to stand strong upon that truth. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Lord God, we pray for this nation. We've turned away from you, Lord, and we promise as a congregation, as a people of this nation, that it is in still you that we trust, and we are still one nation under God, That's you, capital G, Jehovah. Yes, one God. Lord, help us to continue to pray for this nation and pray for this nation's leaders that we turn to you for all the decisions that need to be made. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Lord God, we pray for a healing. There's a number of people who are in need of your healing touch, all in body, mind, and spirit. Lord, we give you the glory for all of the walking miracles that are even here today, Lord. You've done so much healing just in the past couple of weeks, Lord, and we give you the praise and glory for that. Lord, we all, because of that praise and glory and those facts of that healing that has happened, Lord, we still pray to you for all of those people who are on our hearts and minds at this time. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Lord God, we pray for all of the soldiers fighting on those front lines for everything we believe here and the freedoms we have. Help them, Lord. Keep them safe. Bring them home, Lord, and help us as a nation to stand by them as they stood by for us all of these years. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Lord, we pray for all law enforcement personnel, fire department personnel, first responders, people in that working in emergency rooms, nurses, doctors, Lord. Help them. Keep them safe, Lord. Protect them. They're out there to help us and serve us, Lord. And they're also often, we're doing stuff that's not only not helping, but putting them in danger themselves. Lord, help us as a community to stand by each one of them. Lord, in your mercy. Lord God, we pray for all those soldiers fighting on the front lines for your gospel truth, all those missionaries that we support individually and as a congregation. Lord, protect them. Protect them from any kind of human evil. Protect them from any kind of evil of Satan. Protect their health, Lord, and the health of their families. Lord, please provide them with the resources that they need to do those ministries that they are called to do. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
If there's anyone who has any prayers that they'd like to make at this time, please go ahead and say them. Into your hands, O Lord, we commend all for whom we pray. Trusting in the mercy of your Son, Jesus, amen. May the peace of the Lord be with you always.
And also with you.
Please share the peace of God with one another. Let us pray. Merciful Father,
we offer with joy and thanksgiving what you have first given us, ourselves, our time, and our possessions, signs of your gracious love. Receive them for the sake of him who offered himself for us, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen.
All right, last Sunday of the month, let's sing the Lord's Prayer. Please rise as you are able.
Thank you.
And may the Lord bless you. May the Lord be gracious to you. May the Lord shine his face upon you and give you his everlasting strength and peace. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen. Amen.
Our closing hymn for today is, When I Survey the Wondrous Cross, still working out of the green hymnal yet, number 482.
Serve the Lord.
Thanks be to God.